Now, when we look at cardiac MR, basically we're looking at technique. We will look at what the possibilities are, and then we will study a few standard broad indications where we use cardiac MR in day-to-day practice. Now, we need a 1.5 Tesla or a 3 Tesla scanner. Today, almost all the new scanners that have been installed in the last 5 years would have cardiac MR capabilities. We use special cardiac sequences. All of these are ECG gated. And unlike cardiac CT, there is a bit of a learning curve, which is why, unless we have radiologists who or cardiologists sometimes who've been trained in the modality, it becomes difficult to start using the modality. What can cardiac MR do? It can tell us about structure. So this is fundamentally what any imaging modality does. It tells us the anatomy and the structure. But what MR does additionally is function. So we can look at systolic function, and here is a short axis, four chamber, and a two chamber view where we are able to address wall motion and then decide whether a particular segment is contracting normally or has hypokinesia or akinesia. We can also look at diastolic dysfunction, but we don't do this on a routine basis. But we can look at transmitral flow. This is a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. We measure the LA volumes and we can get the typical curves. But as I said, we don't do this on a routine basis. The other functional analysis that we can do is flow analysis. So here is a patient who has in the left ventricular outflow tract or the LVOT view, you can see both aortic stenosis and regurgitation. And we have special sequences. This is a transaxial view that shows us how much the aortic valve is opening. And then we have a specific sequence that allows us to measure the velocity. So here is a 66-year-old man with aortic regurgitation. This is the LVOT view. You can see the regurgitant jet here. And then we can measure the peak velocity, which is 1.8 meters per second, and then calculate the gradient using Bernoulli's equation. But here, this one was for measuring the regurgitant fraction, which is 55%. So that's something that we can do quite easily. We can also measure the QPQS. So here's a 21-year-old with pulmonary hypertension. On the four chamber, you can see how the RV is markedly dilated. So the function is fine. The MPA here is also dilated. And when we looked at the QPQS, so measuring the flow at the same level in the ascending aorta and the pulmonary artery, you can see the absolute stroke volume is three times in the pulmonary artery as compared to the aorta with a QPQS of three. So we went back to look for a left to right shunt. And here we see this anomalous drainage of the right superior pulmonary vein into the superior vena cava. And there was a sinus venosus ASD. So we got the diagnosis, we confirmed the cause of the PH, and all of that was possible using both anatomic as well as functional imaging. The third thing that cardiac MR does is tissue characterization. And we have special sequences that allow us to look at different properties of the myocardium. One of them is delayed enhancement, also called late gadolinium enhancement or late GAD enhancement. After we inject gadolinium, which is a type of contrast medium like iodine, which is used in catheter angiography, about 7 to 10 minutes later, any area of infarction, infiltration, or fibrosis will enhance. And these have different patterns of enhancement. So an infarct would be either subendocardial or transmural, whereas infiltration or fibrosis is typically mid-myocardial, epicardial, or transmural, as you see here. And you can see here that it's transmural on the short axis view in the anteroseptal segment. But as it moves into the anterior wall, you see that it becomes more epicardial or mid-myocardial going to epicardial. The other sequence we have is T1 mapping. Now, T1 mapping allows us to look at a specific property called the T1 property, which is increased in fibrosis and is reduced in patients who have iron and fat depositions. Now, here's a patient with amyloidosis. You can see that there is thickening of the myocardium on this four-chamber view. However, the systolic function is more or less maintained. You can see the normal RV function here. When we looked at the late GAD, we found that there was patchy abnormal subendocardial enhancement, and we didn't get a very good image, and that is also characteristic of amyloidosis. But the T1 here is greater than 1400. Normal T1 is in our setup 1295, and this is in a patient who has a thickened myocardium with this kind of enhancement. This is very characteristic of amyloidosis. The other thing that we look for is the T2, and we do this with T2 mapping, and sometimes we'll use something called the STIR sequence. And the only reason to talk about it is because you have different things that are looked at by these different sequences. So T2 mapping is used for looking for edema. So here is a patient who presented with what looked like an acute coronary syndrome. The catheter angiogram was normal. You can see that there's mildly reduced systolic function. The T1 was high, the T2 was high, which means that there is definite edema. And we find late GAD enhancement here in the anteroseptal segment. So there is edema and there is fibrosis both. And on a follow-up study after 3 to 6 months, we would be able to figure out what is the residual fibrosis, how much the edema has reduced. Not all patients come for follow-up studies because once they improve, there is no real reason for that to happen. But nevertheless, these are possibilities. Here is a 67-year-old, acute chest pain, raised trop levels, normal ejection fraction. You can see on the four-chamber, two-chamber, and short axis that the contractility and thickening is normal. And then here is the T1 map, which is high. The T2 map shows high values. The STIR image does not show any significant abnormality, though there's a little diffuse increased signal here, and there is no late GAD enhancement. So there is edema, there is no fibrosis, no infarction as well. So this gives us a diagnosis of acute myocarditis. Now, whether it's viral, whether it's due to anything else, that's a different issue, but we're able to make a diagnosis of acute myocarditis. The last sequence we have for tissue characterization is something called T2 star. And the only reason, so the way to remember it is late GAD after injection of gadolinium for infarction and fibrosis, T1 mapping for infiltration and fibrosis, T2 mapping for edema, and T2 star is used for mapping of iron. So this is typically used in thalassemic patients who are on blood transfusions. To look for the iron deposition in the heart, we have a special sequence that allows us to see the iron and then we can quantify it. And if we have a T2 star value that is less than 20 milliseconds, then we know that there's iron in the heart. These patients typically come for echo just to look for function, but eventually we do look for function on the MR as well. And the basic interaction is with hematologists. We don't really interact with cardiologists when it comes to T2 star imaging here. So unless the patient actually has failure, it's only then that the patient is referred to you as a cardiologist. So this is to start with. These are the capabilities of cardiac MR, where we can look at structure, we can look at systolic and diastolic function, we can look at flow, and we can look at different aspects to characterize the myocardium. Now let's look at the indications. We use cardiac MR on a regular day-to-day basis to accurately evaluate volumes and quantify. We use cardiac MR for cardiomyopathies. These are our largest bulk of indications. The next would be viability and ischemia imaging, then pericardial disease, neoplasms, and thrombi. We don't do a lot of valvular imaging because echo is so good. So it's only a rare patient who would come, and I will not discuss this further. I've already shown you what the capabilities are. And In congenital heart disease, and I do only adult congenital, we use cardiac MR to answer specific questions, typically related to the right heart. So, when it comes to volumes and quantification, cardiac MR is the gold standard for measurement of ejection fraction. So, we take the short axis stack from the apex to the base, and then we actually, in a semi-quantitative manner, will measure both the mass as well as the ejection fraction. So, the computer will allow us to draw the line along the endocardium, the line along the epicardium in end-diastole and end-systole, and then we actually get the ejection fraction, the end-diastolic volume, the end-systolic volume, and the end-diastolic wall mass. So all of these parameters come in. Obviously, it's not something that we would use on a day-to-day basis just to measure the ejection fraction. Echo is absolutely fine for that. But when it comes to clinical trials, when we are looking at patients with cardiomyopathy specifically to track what is happening to their systolic function, then cardiac MR becomes the gold standard. When you are looking at a cardiac MR report, if the report doesn't have a mention of the ejection fraction and the volumes, then that means that it is a substandard report. Every cardiac MR report, except in pediatric congenital heart disease, must always mention the ejection fraction. That is the standard of care as far as reports are concerned. So let's move on to the cardiomyopathies. And cardiac MR is useful in the granulomatous cardiomyopathies, in restrictive cardiomyopathies, and all the hypertrophic variants, in ARVC, and in iron overload. So we've already spoken about iron overload. Let's look at granulomatous cardiomyopathy. These patients present with monomorphic ventricular tachycardia, abnormal enhancement on MR, and often have lymphadenopathy. And the two diagnoses we need to consider in our country would be sarcoidosis and tuberculosis. So this is typically how they present. This is a young patient who has biventricular involvement. You can see reduced RV and LV function on the four-chamber view. The patient has a TR jet. You can see that on the short axis as well. But what the late GAD images show us is abnormal epicardial enhancement, almost forming a ring around the LV. There is abnormal RV enhancement as well. This is abnormal septal enhancement, telling us that there is extensive biventricular fibrosis. Now, this patient had enlarged subcarinal and right hilar lymph nodes. They were necrotic. We biopsied a necrotic right axillary lymph node, and this turned out to be tuberculosis. Sarcoid presents in exactly the same manner, and therefore it can be a challenge to differentiate the etiology, and there are different flow charts that are available to do that. But here is a 43-year-old man with sarcoidosis. You can see that there is depressed overall systolic function with marked thinning of the basal anteroseptal segment, which also shows a focus of fibrosis. We use cardiac MR to follow up these patients, and in October, this patient deteriorated. The LV is larger now. There is an increase in the hypokinesia and akinesia, and the fibrosis has markedly increased in the anteroseptal segment. And now we also see subendocardial fibrosis along the lateral and inferior walls, some epicardial fibrosis as well. And so clearly, this patient is progressing and would probably require an AICD as well to prevent any further possibility of sudden cardiac death, etc. The next thing we look at would be the restrictive cardiomyopathies. And restrictive cardiomyopathies present with reduced diastolic filling. The systolic function may be normal, and they usually have biatrial enlargement, and they have abnormal myocardial enhancement. The typical restrictive cardiomyopathies are endomyocardial fibrosis, amyloidosis, and glycogen storage disorders. Now, here is a patient who presented subacutely with a dyspnea and was in failure. We can see the biatrial enlargement on the four chamber. You can see the LA enlargement on the two chamber view. The systolic function seems to be relatively preserved, but there is some thickening of the inferior and anterior walls. But if you look at the late gadolinium enhancement, we have an arrow-shaped enhancement pattern here, which is very, very typical of endomyocardial fibrosis. And so this patient had subacute endomyocardial fibrosis, did not survive despite aggressive treatment. Here is a 53-year-old man in failure, and we can see marked thickening of the LV segments. And the moment we have thickening of the LV segments, you know, it's either hypertrophy or it's infiltrative disease. You can see that the RV also shows thickening. There is biatrial enlargement. There is a mild MR as well that we can see on the four-chamber view. And basically, we need to now figure out what's happening. So amyloidosis is clearly on the cards. The T1 here is sky high. We see this abnormal pattern of diffuse enhancement. And if you see here, it's all the four chambers show abnormal enhancement. So this is amyloidosis classically involving all the chambers of the heart and a relatively easy diagnosis to make. What about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy? We can differentiate among the different types of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, see whether there is subaortic obstruction, and then risk stratify based upon the extent of fibrosis. Apical HCM is easy to diagnose and often is seen even when the echo is normal, simply because that is known to happen sometimes with milder forms of apical HCM. And these are the various findings that we would have. So let's quickly go to a patient. We can see the two-chamber view here. You see that ace of spades appearance here with the apical systolic obliteration. This is what we see on the short axis views, and this is what we see on the four-chamber view. So this is a classic but severe apical HCM. Here is your ace of spades appearance of the residual LV cavity and a classic apical HCM. I know there are some things coming up on the chat, but I will look at the chat only at the end of the lecture, and if there are any questions, then I will answer them at that time. Now, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy has different phenotypes, which we are able to see well on MR. The extent and distribution of fibrosis has a bearing on prognosis. Our electrophysiologists routinely now ask us to quantify the extent of fibrosis, and if it's more than 15%, then they usually think of putting an ICD inside. So here is a typical patient who has marked hypertrophy here. In fact, the end-diastolic wall thickness of the septum was about 29 millimeters, so almost reaching the 30 millimeters that we would look at. Here, we can see an MR. We can see the subaortic jet here of the subaortic obstruction because of SAM. And here is the abnormal fibrosis. So on the short axis view, we see all these white areas that represent fibrosis. This patient had more than 25% of the myocardium involved by the fibrosis, and clearly this patient is at risk for sudden cardiac death. Here is another kind of patient where there is a mid-cavity HCM, there's mid-cavity obliteration. And then we have an apical aneurysm with akinesia and thinning. This is something that is known to happen in these patients, likely because of ischemia related to this classic mid-cavity configuration. This is a patient who has septum predominant HCM. We can see the late systolic apposition of the anterior mitral valve leaflet to the septum, and here is the subaortic obstruction. This is the jet that we see. That's the aortic valve, and that tells us that, you know, this patient obviously has LVOT obstruction. Now, the point is we can't actually measure the flow well because technically there is a challenge, and so we don't look at the extent of the LVOT obstruction or the subaortic obstruction. We just mention whether it is present or not. The next cardiomyopathy that is easy to diagnose is ARVC, where we get progressive degeneration of the right ventricle because of fibrosis and fatty replacement. And this is what it looks morphologically. Obviously, we look at the task force criteria, measure the RV ejection fraction, the end-diastolic volume index to the surface area. But look at this here, right? We have virtually no contractility. There is pseudo-sacculation along the anterior wall. The LV is actually quite normal, and this is what classic severe ARVC looks like. So that was as far as the cardiomyopathies were concerned. Let's look at viability imaging. Let's look at ischemic cardiomyopathies, etc. So what can cardiac MR do as far as viability imaging is concerned? So in a patient who has had an infarct, if the wall motion is normal, then clearly the myocardium is viable. But if there is a wall motion abnormality, then we need to figure out whether this patient has myocardium that is viable to justify revascularization. So this patient has normal myocardium. This patient has akinesia of the mid-inferior wall and inferior lateral segment. Most of the mid-lateral wall here extending into the apical lateral wall, the apical anterior wall, etc. The principles are that all infarcts enhance. In fact, immediately after an infarct, you will get enhancement, and that continues forever. All non-enhancing myocardium is potentially viable. And so we assess the areas of systolic dysfunction, assess the absence, present, and extent of infarction, and then figure out whether this is viable or non-viable. So let me give you an example and let me show you how we do this. So on the short axis stack, we will look for the presence of normal myocardium or figure out whether it's mildly or severely hypokinetic or akinetic. And here we can see that the basal lateral and inferior wall is contracting well. As we get into the mid cavity, we see that the mid inferior wall and inferior lateral segment are fine, but the rest are all akinetic. And as we go to the apical segments, everything is akinetic. And this is then put in a bullseye chart so that it's easy to understand when we're looking at the report. Then we look at the areas of infarction. And here we can see that everything is full thickness, but sometimes you would get less than 25% or 25 to 50%, etc. So here we have full transmural infarction, the black areas, and we saw these black areas to be normal, right? In the when we were looking at the wall motion, we knew that these were contracting well too. So the areas that were not are showing transmural infarction, which we again put in the bullseye chart here. So we see that in the areas of systolic dysfunction, there is transmural infarction. So all of this is non-viable myocardium. And so that's the report that we would give here, that in this patient who has an LAD lesion on the cath angio, this is non-viable myocardium in the LAD territory, and perhaps revascularization would not be of help in this patient. So this is how we look at things. If the systolic function is normal, then normal. If the systolic function is abnormal, then we look at the late GAD images. If there is no infarction, then obviously this is viable hibernating myocardium. If there is infarction and it's less than 25%, then it's viable hibernating. Greater than 50% to transmural, it's non-viable. And if it's in this 25 to 50% category, then there's a 50% chance of improvement. And these patients, a dobutamine stress echo would be of real help to figure out whether these patients actually will improve with revascularization or not. What else can we do with this? So here is a 62-year-old man with acute failure and chest pain. And we can see here that this patient has in the area of acute infarction, you can see the abnormal enhancement here, has developed an infarct-related VSD. This patient did not survive the journey back to the nursing home from where he had been sent and passed away because of this acute infarct-related VSD. So what about ischemia? And let's look at one example of a 63-year-old man with multivessel disease who came for assessment of LAD ischemia. Now, we can already see a transmural infarct in the RCA territory, but there's no infarction in the LAD territory. And the question was, is there ischemia? And so we did an adenosine stress perfusion MR. Here we can see on the short axis Sine images that there is hypokinesia. Now, when there is hypokinesia, clearly we would expect that the patient would have ischemia. But if you look at the anterior wall and anterolateral segment, that is contracting well. So the question still is there ischemia or not? Now, this is the adenosine stress MR. So we give gadolinium. We look at the first pass of the gadolinium at the time when we're giving the adenosine. And if I just freeze the frame here, you can see clearly that there is this ischemic hypointensity or black area extending from the anterolateral segment all the way to the inferoceptal segment. So the entire LAD territory shows ischemia on adenosine stress perfusion, telling us that there is inducible ischemia. Inferior wall, we already know, is infarcted, therefore it doesn't, I mean, that doesn't come into the picture. But if this patient's LAD is revascularized, then clearly this patient's ischemia should improve. And that's the information that we get here. And we can quantify this. So we have lots of these lovely softwares now that allow us to not only look at this visually, but to look at this quantitatively as well. And recently I was asked to do a lecture in a Nuclear Medicine Society meeting, and where we found that most head-to-head studies of CMR and PET show equivalence. So you can do a pneumonia PET, you can do a stress PET, or you can do a stress CMR, and you'd get similar results. So we can look at aneurysms as well. We can differentiate, and you can see on the two-chamber view here the apical aneurysm. You can differentiate a true from a false aneurysm, and then give more information that would help the surgeon decide whether an aneurysectomy needs to be done along with a CABG or not. Let's look at neoplasms and thrombi. This is a very classic hydatid cyst here along the lateral wall of the LV. This is a hydatid cyst anywhere in the body where you see these bright areas with septate. But these are rare. We see them maybe once in a couple of years. What we see often are thrombi and other masses. Here is an LV apical thrombus. This was a 36-year-old lady who presented with stroke, and then the echo showed a focal lesion, but they were not sure whether it was a thrombus or a mass. Now, here we can see an area of akinesia in the apex. A cath angio was normal, so this was likely related to some embolic episode that had resulted in an apical infarction. Now, because of the apical akinesia, a thrombus had formed here, which was basically floating within the LV cavity and dislodging small emboli that led to her stroke. Here is a patient who has these multiple nodular lesions. This was a 52-year-old man within the LV cavity. We looked at the late GAD and we found patchy enhancement. The T1 was markedly elevated. We then did a PET-CT and we did a CT as well, which showed the same nodular masses, but the PET showed a mass in the thyroid, and this eventually turned out to be thyroid carcinoma with metastases. We're often called upon to look at angiosarcomas on the right side. We're called upon to look for metastatic disease. We're also called upon in patients who have suspected myxomas to see and differentiate myxomas from thrombi, et cetera. And I can always discuss that in a subsequent lecture when we look at neoplasms. What about constrictive pericarditis? So that classic conundrum of restrictive cardiomyopathy versus constrictive pericarditis is not an issue on MR, because if it is a restrictive cardiomyopathy, we will see myocardial disease. And if it's constrictive pericarditis, then we will see pericardial disease. So here we have a patient who has a thickened, I mean, these are the findings. We would see a thickened pericardium greater than 4 millimeters and or pericardial calcification, and then other findings that tell us that there is a restrictive physiology, but we can also see septal bounce on something called real-time imaging. Now, this is a patient who had tuberculous pericarditis in the past, and this is a classic appearance, a banana-shaped LV, where we see this focal low signal area just distal to the AV groove. There is biatrial enlargement here. And it's always good to do a CT scan in these patients. And look at what we see. We see a ring, a constricting ring of calcification here that is producing this constrictive pericarditis. And this is the sequel. This is one of those things that we see as a sequel of tuberculous pericarditis. And then just removing this and stripping this off is enough to make the patient asymptomatic. Now, here is another patient, and on these anatomy images, we see that the pericardium is thickened. It's greater than 4 millimeters. And here I wanted to show you the septal bounce on the real-time imaging. So in real-time imaging, as the patient is breathing and the heart is contracted, we just run one long sequence. And if you see here, when the diaphragm comes down, which is an inspiration, if I just put my cursor here on the septum, you will see that the septum deviates into the LV cavity. So let's look at it once again here. As the diaphragm comes down, the septum's moving into the LV cavity. That is the paradoxical septal deviation that we see because of the pressure dissociation between the LV and RV when there is constrictive pericarditis. We come to the last part here and we look at congenital cases. The typical indications are in assessing the anatomy of a complex congenital heart disease when a pediatric cardiologist or somebody who looks at this on a daily basis is still at a loss to explain what is going on, to look at the functional significance of lesions. And then in the adult congenital hearts, typically in the post-tetralogy patients, to look at the valvular and RV pathology. And then sometimes for shunt evaluation, for sizing before putting an ASD occluder, etc. In my practice, we only do adult congenital. We don't do pediatric congenital. We're not geared up for that. But here is a patient who was operated for tetralogy at 1 year after birth and is now 21 years old, comes with severe right-sided failure. And you can see here what's happened. There's a tight stenosis. This is an RV-OT view. And this is perpendicular to that. And you can see this tight stenosis along the pulmonary valve with this jet. And look at what's happened to the RV. The RV is barely contracting. And on the short axis view, we can see that it's almost hypokinetic. The RV ejection fraction that we measured came to 5 to 10%, which really is extremely low. And we don't even know why the patient waited this long. You can see the fixed septal deviation into the LV because of the increased RV volume. So this patient had an emergency valvuloplasty done with a balloon, improved immediately, and again ran away. God knows why. So then we don't have a follow-up on this patient. Here's another patient. You can see how the RV is large here. But if you look at the RVOT, we see typically what we get, a free PR, and we can then measure the ejection, the regurgitant fraction, and an associated PS. So there's a PS and there is a PR that we can appreciate in this patient. So in the last 35 odd minutes, what I've done is I've given you a basic idea of what cardiac MR can do. So my brief, as per Ranjit, was to just introduce the subject. We talked about the various things it can do, looking at structure, looking at different types of function, systolic, diastolic dysfunction, and flow. And then the parametric imaging that we do to characterize the myocardium with T1, T2 mapping, with T2 star for iron overload, and looking at late gadolinium images for infarction and fibrosis. And then these are the various indications. In every patient, we measure the ejection fraction. All the different forms of cardiomyopathies are indications for cardiac MR, and bulk of our work essentially is iron overload, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, basically looking at the fibrosis and sometimes diagnosing a apical HCM, patients to come in to rule out ARVC, all the dilated cardiomyopathies to figure out whether we can find out an etiology, etc. We do a lot of viability imaging. This is our second commonest indication. And this is typically in patients with reduced ejection fraction, where the surgeon sends these patients trying to figure out whether it's worth revascularizing or not. And we've started doing some amount of ischemia imaging. We started doing adenosine stress perfusion just about 9 to 10 months ago. We obviously do a lot of pericardial imaging, but sometimes it's with CT, sometimes with MR. More and more, we're looking at neoplasms, and the two common ones, or the three common things that we do, are one is looking at thrombi and complex thrombi, the second is differentiating myxomas from thrombi, and third is complex tumors, especially the right-sided angiosarcomas and lymphomas. Very rarely, once in about 2, 3 months, we look at an adult aortic valve, especially when the patient has gone shopping, has looked at multiple echoes, and or there are multiple echoes which give different gradients, and then sometimes we do an MR for that. And then in adult congenital heart disease, if there are specific questions, typically in post-operative patients, to look at the right heart. So I thank you for your attention, and I will look at the chat box now to see if there are any questions and then take it from there. So let's start with the first one from Dr. Shanmuga. Can you suggest a good source of information on CMR for cardiologists regarding reporting images, etc.? Well, there are articles and books. Unfortunately, there are no simple, concise books as to how to report images. And the best thing to do is to attend a course. There are many centers, as well as our Indian Academy of Cardiac Imaging, where we do these courses on cases to show how to report and read, etc. Everyone in waiting room from the host, that's fine.
So there was one question that was posted to me privately, where Dr. Shanmuga has asked you to comment on CMR and heart failure. Common issue is breath holding. So how do you circumvent this issue?
It's not really an issue. I mean, you just technically we can change the various parameters to reduce the scan time to work with breath holding. I know that sometimes if the patient is an acute failure, that's a problem. We've had patients coming in with low ejection fraction, stable for viability imaging, and then with all the breath holding they have to do, they actually go into failure at about 20, 25 minutes. But we can change our sequences. And sometimes we actually move into real-time imaging as well, if required, to just look at the function very quickly. So there are different ways of doing that. Okay, how do we measure the RV dysfunction with CMR? Visually, we can say whether there's good contractility, thickening, etc. But then we can actually, like we measure LV, we measure RV. Some people do it on Sine axials, and some people do it on the short axis stack, and both of them give equal results. Okay, Dr. Vishnu Ravila, what is the recommended method of scar quantification? So we use the half-width full maximum technique. That's a technical term, but there are different ways of doing it. The idea is to use the same method in the same center. There are many pitfalls to that. It's not an absolute foolproof technique, but that's what we do. Vidya, thank you. Thanks to a lot of the people who are saying thank you. Please explain T1 mapping. So what we do really, and maybe I can go to the slide very quickly and show that to you. So technically, there is a special sequence. It's called the Molly sequence, which gives you about 11 or 12 images at different endpoints or different echo times, but it's a T1 weighted sequence. And then you have the software that calculates the T1 value from this. The T1 value for each center has to be characterized. So in our center, it's 1295 milliseconds. We obtained that on about 20 or 25 normals. Now, when the T1 is increased, it means that there is something within the myocardium that is increasing it. Now, if it's iron or fat, then it will reduce it, because iron or fat anywhere in the body reduces the T1. But if there is fluid, if there is fibrosis, if there is abnormal protein, as happens with amyloid, or abnormal glycogen, as happens with the storage disorders, then the T1 is increased. So when the T1 is increased, it only tells you that there's something abnormal in the myocardium, and you still have to put everything together and look at all the rest of the sequences for that. Okay, please explain role in ischemia again. Well, we use adenosine stress perfusion to tell us whether a normally contracting myocardium is ischemic or not, just like you would do with dobutamine as well. But dobutamine looks at contractility, adenosine looks at vasodilatation. Parag Bhavaskar, does presence of LG indicate acute sarcoidosis? Can CMR replace FDG PET for follow-up of sarcoid? So LG does not indicate active sarcoid, it just tells us that there is fibrosis. When we use T1 and T2 mapping, on the T2 mapping, if we see edema, then we know that there's activity. But late GAD in the defined clinical setting would kind of be a surrogate for activity. Can CMR replace FDG PET? So when I did that nuclear medicine talk, we realized that FGD PET has a lot of pitfalls as well. It can tell you that there's active inflammation, but first of all, it doesn't tell you that it's sarcoid. It's only in a patient with known sarcoid that when you see active abnormality on the FDG PET, you say, okay, here is a patient who has active inflammation. But it's very bad for fibrosis. And so once we want to start looking at fibrosis as a prognostic factor and then follow up the patients, FDG PET is not good enough as well. So there's a lot of stuff where, you know, we are saying you should do an FDG PET to start with, then do an MR to look at the fibrosis, and then follow up on MR. The challenge, of course, is that if you're going to put an ICD, then the MR can be a challenge on follow-up because you will still always get some artifacts. We can do an MR in patients with ICDs now and pacemakers. That's not a problem, but sometimes you get artifacts that can prevent accurate comparison. Okay, we often receive suboptimal images report due to inability to breath hold and tachyarrhythmias. Yes, you can troubleshoot. Troubleshooting is by using real-time imaging, by changing the parameters to, you know, do it much faster. There are ways and means, but that's, you know, you'd have to be on the console to be able to do that. There was one case shown, this is by Somal Pandya, of LV metastasis on thyroid primary. How do we differentiate infiltrative from LV mets? You can't. I mean, this patient had nodular disease, so we presumed that it was tumor. And so we asked for a PET CT. We've had lymphomas presenting like amyloid. But invariably there is something else that we see that tells us, okay, you know, we're dealing with what looks like a tumor, either there's some nodularity or there's disease in the lungs or there's lymphadenopathy, etc. You have to look at the total picture, not just at the MR itself. Pavan Gupta, okay, I've already talked about T1 mapping. Can we get a template for cardiac MR reporting? We have one template. I could share it with you, but you'd have to probably message me separately. Deepanjan, again, T1 mapping, we've already done that. Website, proper book, I'm sorry. There is a paucity of that. I am in the process of writing a book. Actually, Dr. Priya Chudgar is writing it, and I'm co-writing it with her. It should be out in about 3 months. Let's see, maybe that would help. Can we do CMR with arrhythmias? Well, if the arrhythmias are ectopics, then yes. But if there's a consistent arrhythmia, then it becomes a problem. So we do send these patients back to the cardiologist to control the arrhythmia with amiodarone and then do it. Measure EF in bigeminy, it can be a challenge. But usually, if the rhythm is otherwise fine, we can manage. Myocarditis will not produce any fibrosis in later stage. Of course it can. We don't know. If it's not there at the beginning, then often it will not be there. But if you're following up on echo and you see a wall motion abnormality, then chances are there is fibrosis and we should actually repeat the MR. Dipti, can septal bounce be seen in any other condition? So not the paradoxical septal deviation seen in inspiration in late systole. You can get a fixed septal deviation like I showed in the patient who had the RV volume overload post-tetralogy. So that can be seen in any RV volume overload. Can we differentiate amyloid and sarcoid? Usually, yes. So amyloid, we also get an abnormal pattern in the early set. We get bad quality images at a specific TI. That's because there's an abnormal protein there. So that is usually not a problem. Is there any clinical value in quantification of LG, especially in post-TOF patient as fibrosis load? No, not in post-tetralogy patients. Can you explain acute myocarditis again? No, it's just that these patients present as an acute coronary syndrome. The cath angio is usually normal, and then they are sent to us with MR both to just confirm that there's myocarditis. So you can get normal ejection fraction, reduced ejection fraction, abnormal enhancement would imply there is fibrosis. And now with T1, T2 mapping, we can look at edema as well. Please take a lecture on nuclear imaging. I'm not a nuclear medicine person, so that has to be done with a nuclear medicine person. What about STIR? I don't find STIR as good as T2 mapping. So now that we have T2 mapping, I don't use it. Location of myocardial fibrosis and sarcoid, most commonly in the basal anteroceptal segment, but it can be anywhere. Do we need dedicated cardiac coil? Yes. Please. All right, perfect. So we're done with the questions. Thank you. And if we need any more focused lectures on specific topics, happy to do them. But Ranjit, you can coordinate that and let me know. All right?
Sure, sir.
Thanks, Ranjit, again, for organizing this. It's been a pleasure. And everyone, be safe. Take care. We're all now starting to go to work in Mumbai, at least from tomorrow and today. So wish us luck. And everybody take care. Bye-bye.